There are a couple of encounters from the past that I want to share before I start writing about recent things that are happening. I think I found more answers to my questions. In this post, I will touch on things that we see in our backyard from time to time that look like little cute animals. Sometimes they're playful little cats, dogs, or chickens. Sometimes they are hurt animals that seek help. However, we are not to interact with them in any situation, as Rule 28 says. Any little animals you see in the backyard, do not approach them no matter what. Those are not animals. When this encounter took place, the weather outside got better. It was gloomy and rained for weeks before we finally had a sunny weekend. I didn't want to waste this opportunity, so I got outside. I exited the house and went straight to the backyard, which had looked into the woods. The backyard had an extremely beautiful garden, table and chairs to sit there, but the dark woods gave some creepy vibe to it. Some of the flowers started to bloom, so I imagined how beautiful it would look during the summer. There was also a pool and a fountain. Not so long after, my sisters joined me. Billy brought her horse toys to play with Anne while Jill and I sat at the table. I remember we didn't talk about the creepy things in the house. We tried to think about something else more positive so we don't have to fight fear every second of our days. Half an hour later, Evangeline came outside too. When she stepped outside, the sun shined on her and I realized how pale she is. I checked her appearance subconsciously, expecting to see change in her expression. She wore a long, dark red skirt that touched her feet, black shirt with lace around its collar which looked like it was from the 19th century. She carried a book and headed towards the chair next to the back exit. We stopped talking and just observed her before we continued.
"I like her outfit," Jill looked at me.
"It's nice," I replied, turning my gaze towards Evangeline, who opened her book.
"You know, she is creepy, but I envy her beauty. I wish I was that beautiful."
Jill smiled a bit when she finished her sentence. "I agree. She is fascinating, actually," I added.
"If I were a man, I would be crazy for her. Seriously, how is she still alone?"
Jill laughed a bit, looking at Evangeline, who slowly moved her blonde hair behind her ear with her skinny long fingers.
"It's either because she's creepy as hell or she's not interested in a relationship," I replied, looking back at Jill.
Her facial expression changed as she looked behind me. I heard soft footsteps and immediately turned around. It was Evangeline staring directly in my eyes. She leaned down a bit and I could smell her perfume now.
"The one I need is crazy for me,"
she said, eyeing me, then Jill, who looked creeped out and confused at the same time.
How did...
I stuttered, trying to form a sentence.
"Knew that you talked about me?"
she finished my question.
"You are not aware of how loud you are."
She backed away and once again looked at us before walking back to her chair.
"Oh my God,"
Jill mumbled. The hair on my back stood up. Were we really that loud, or does this woman have a special hearing ability?
"We were probably too loud," I said, biting my bottom lip. "Yeah."
Jill paused, then continued.
"She may be beautiful, but she gives me the creeps."
"The best is to avoid talking about her when she's near." Jill nodded and we changed subject again.
"Lunch will be served in 30 minutes,
Lizzie shouted from the back door. I immediately looked at her direction, then back at Jill, who stood up, ready to go inside. Billy and Anne collected their toys. Evangeline also stood up from her chair and closed her book. We walked towards the door without noticing Billy isn't walking with us. We were about to enter when I turned around for some unknown reason. Whatever made me turn around, I'm thankful because I saved my sister.
"Billy!"
I shouted, running towards her. She was walking towards a gray kitten that friendly meowed and wanted to play with her. Billy didn't turn around when I shouted. Instead, she reached with her hand to pet the animal when I grabbed her, pulling her back. I was basically carrying her in my arms now.
"Billy, what are you doing?" I yelled.
I didn't mean to, but part of me was scared for her safety and wanted to show her how dangerous it was. It was from best intentions.
"That's a kitty. I wanted to play with her,"
she replied, looking up at me while I carried her. "That is not a cat, Billy. Rule said so. Who knows what could have happened to you? Do you want to die?" I was getting angry at this point. Her naive and careless nature brought us some problems. I forgave her when Maya almost killed me because of her. It was an accident. She didn't do that intentionally. But this, she intentionally approached that cat.
No,
she said when I put her down. Others were standing and looking at us when Evangeline approached her.
You again.
She looked down at Billy, who lowered her head.
You are causing this trouble again. Is something not clear about the rules? Or are you not an obedient child?
Her voice stayed the same, but you could feel the poison in it.
Look at me when I'm talking to you.
Billy lifted her head and tears could be visible in her eyes. Evangeline's non-changing face looked more scary in moments like these.
Do you know what would happen if you touched that little animal?
Billy just looked down again and her silent sobs could be heard.
Evangeline, why are you so mean to her?
Jill asked when she heard Billy sobbing. Evangeline just looked at her, then at the little kitty that was meowing for us to come near her. She started walking towards it and picked up a big rock from the ground. Something in my stomach turned as I knew what that means. Even if I was aware of the rules, I still didn't want to see anything disturbing. When she was near the cat that now laid on her back, begging to be played with, Evangeline threw the rock at her, causing her to scream in pain. We all flinched. But that wasn't enough for Evangeline. She took the rock again and started hitting the small animal over and over again, causing blood to splash from the green grass.
Stop it!
Jill shouted while tears streamed down her face.
You witch! How could you?
My eyes were glued to the sight, even though a part of me wanted to look away. Anne covered her eyes and sobbed quietly. Evangeline hit the cat again and she finally became silent. I was shaking at this point. How was she capable of doing something like that? It wasn't even a monster. It was a small kitten that never hurt anyone and she murdered her. She turned around and started walking towards us, drops of blood on her face while her expression never changed. We started to back up a little, being afraid of her now more than ever. Evangeline got closer to us, but we noticed movement in the place where she killed the cat. Its dead body started to twitch uncontrollably, and a loud screeching sound erupted from it. Evangeline grabbed Billy's hand, which covered her eyes and forced her to watch. Two spider-like legs appeared and the creature stood up. It wasn't too big, with two legs that were sharp at the end, something like spider legs. It had big claws on its hands and a hole in the middle of its face filled with dozens of sharp teeth.
Do you see now what happens?
Evangeline gripped Billy's shoulders as she frantically nodded.
Oh my god,
Anne screamed when that thing launched at us.
Get in the house,
Cousin demanded, even now without changing the tone of her voice. We quickly got in and she locked the door at the moment when the creature slammed into it. She scanned all of us with her eyes and her gaze stopped on Billy.
Show your right hand.
Billy looked at her, then hesitantly opened her palm. She was holding a purple crystal attached to a chain.
You found that outside?
Billy again nodded and lowered her head down.
Didn't the rules specifically tell you not to do that? What is wrong with you? Are you suicidal or purposely getting on my nerves? Or you want us all dead? I thought it was beautiful.
Billy sobbed out.
I don't care what you thought. I will have to discipline you.
Evangeline grabbed her hand and took away the necklace. She then grabbed Billy and started dragging her behind her.
No, no, please, I didn't mean anything bad.
Billy cried. Evangeline, leave her alone. I tried grabbing her wrist, but she grabbed mine.
I'm taking her to her own mother. I don't want anything to do with this misbehaved child.
What is happening here? My mother walked in.
Why are you yelling at Billy and what happened? You have to talk to this child. She broke two rules at once,
Evangeline said, letting go of Billy's wrist.
Oh God, Billy, come here.
Mom sighed and Billy ran to her.
Lunch will be served in a couple of minutes. You should go eat.
We went towards the dining room while Mom and Billy went towards the bathroom. Evangeline walked up the stairs with the necklace Billy found in the garden. We had lunch together and no one dared to say a word about anything. I couldn't forget how Evangeline killed that cat, which turned into a monster and almost hurt us. Even though that scene was disturbing to watch, she did it to show us the danger of that rule. It is disturbing and I dream about it often. It haunts me at night. But what worries me more is what would that thing do to Billy? The necklace Billy brought in her house was never mentioned again. We were not allowed to go outside a couple of days after it. Windows were covered and we were forbidden from looking outside. Weird tapping was heard a couple of nights and knocking on the window glass. I didn't sleep much those days. If you combine the sounds from outside and the ones inside, it is a complete hell. Someone asked me about the bleeding walls and my experience with it. It's one of the recent encounters that I had. Also, what happened to the wall surely has some connection with that blue room at the end of the hallway. After this, I'm really curious to find out what's behind that door. I finished my lesson that day and decided to listen to music a little bit in the living room. I took my headphones and sat on the sofa. I wanted to relax a little bit since the morning that day was pretty calm and no crazy shit occurred. Before I even managed to play one song, the doorbell rang. I got up and walked towards the door. It was a delivery man. He had a package for Evangeline. I called her from downstairs and she quickly came. She took her package, but the young delivery man started to flirt with her. I don't blame him, though. She's an extremely attractive woman. She just looked at him and blinked while he tried to compliment her. On his compliment that she's pretty like a doll, she just responded with, "I know. Goodbye." And she closed the door in his face. I stood behind the whole time watching what was going on. She just glanced at me and climbed up the stairs carrying her package. I went back to the living room and sat on the sofa. I played some relaxing song and leaned back closing my eyes. A couple of seconds into the song, I felt something wet fall on my nose. My eyes shoot open and immediately I touched my nose. A red stain was on my fingers and I lifted my head to the ceiling. The crack in the ceiling was bleeding and another drop fell on my face. "Evangeline!" I yelled, leaving my headphones on the sofa and running up the stairs. I grabbed the handle of her bedroom door, but it was locked. "Evangeline!" "Yes?" her voice answered from the library. "The walls are bleeding!" I heard her rushing footsteps. She lifted her head and noticed those cracks are also bleeding. She looked at me and ordered, "Stay downstairs in the living room, and don't go up there no matter what. If others come home, make sure they stay with you." I nodded, rushed down the stairs toward the living room. What will happen now? Will I encounter another creepy thing? Will I even survive this? My heart was beating so hard I could hear it in my ears. I sat down on the sofa and tried to calm myself down. If I stay here and obey her, maybe nothing will happen. I looked around, noticing every crack on the wall bleeding. Atmosphere in the house became darker, scarier, like something is lurking behind these walls. Something evil, malicious, and disturbing. I could feel the air in the house getting colder and the smell started to change. For a second, I thought that rule number 21 would come into play, but I realized that I can smell blood instead of decomposed flesh. I looked at the spot on the sofa behind me. It had drops of blood that fell down from the ceiling on it. I was starting to get cold, so I rubbed my hands together to warm them up a little bit. My hoodie was upstairs, but I couldn't go there. I looked around while praying silently that this will stop soon, before anything else happens, but my hope faded as I realized the screen on the TV turned to static. Rule 25. If the screen on the TV turns to static, turn it off and leave the living room. You will hear moaning and the sound of metal hitting the floor. Do not close the door, do not look back, and don't go there until the sound stops completely. She can be tricky and make a pause for a minute or two just to lure you in while you think it stopped. I have to get out of the living room, no matter what Evangeline said. Maybe if I hide in another room, I'll be safe. I quickly turned off the TV and rushed towards the door. Then I started to hear metal dragging on the floor. It scared me so much that without thinking, I started climbing up the stairs only to realize that I disobeyed Evangeline. I was halfway up when I realized that, which caused me to immediately turn around. This time, I could hear moaning. Despite being scared as hell, I peeked a little from the stairs so I could see a little bit of what was happening in the living room. The first thing that I noticed was a creature that looked like a really skinny naked female. She had a little bit of hair on her head. It looked like someone ripped off some of her hair. Her ribs were pulled outside from her back, resembling wings. She was eyeless with two holes bleeding and a big chain coming out of her mouth. At the moment I caught a glimpse of her, I quietly but quickly rushed up the stairs, not caring about what Evangeline said. I just hoped she didn't see me because rule forbid me from looking behind. If she comes after me, I'm fucked. When I got upstairs, I immediately noticed the smell of blood that got stronger. Besides the moaning from downstairs, I heard a quiet growling sound and a female voice mumbling something. I took a couple of steps forward, thinking about what it could be. The more I walked forward, the more I realized those sounds were coming from that blue room. I know that we are strictly forbidden from coming near this room, and Evangeline could catch me, but my curiosity basically pushed me to walk forward. My heart was beating so loud now, and my breathing became faster. I slowed down a bit, carefully walking not to make a sound. From the other side of the door came growling, then a soft male voice in a lower pitch, followed by a raspy voice in a higher pitch. That is the best way to describe it. It's like two voices talked at the same time. I couldn't understand what it was saying. The female voice that could also be heard sounded familiar, but I couldn't remember where I heard it. The only thing I could make out of what it said was, "Toby, he wasn't going to hurt me. I don't care about him." The voice was so damn familiar to me, but I couldn't remember where I heard it. Who was that? And more important question, who is Toby? Is it another creature? I took another step forward closer to the door when I heard sounds of change from the other side that caused me to flinch. I turned around, hoping that woman from downstairs didn't come after me. When I saw nothing, I realized it really came from behind those doors. Something is there. That's why Evangeline doesn't allow us near this room, and I'm breaking the rule. "Is something bothering my Toby?" the female voice asked, followed by the sound of growling. I took a couple of steps back from the door. Maybe it could feel my presence and I could get in trouble. The sounds on the other side became muffled. The sound of the entrance door unlocking shook me from my thoughts. Mom must be back. That's when I realized I can't hear the thing from the living room anymore. Quietly, I walked down the stairs and explained to my mom how Evangeline told me that we can't go upstairs because the walls are bleeding. I didn't tell her I disobeyed cousin because she would go crazy. I also didn't tell her anything about what I heard in that blue room sparked more interest in me than anything else. I think that recent events that I'll share with you could give more answers to my questions. The next thing I wanted to talk about was those wax and porcelain dolls that are everywhere around the house. There were many theories about them and I considered them all. I still don't have the answers that I want. The only thing I can think is that they're another creature pretending to be dolls and can actually be really harmful. I have experience with them. One of them appeared in my bedroom, but luckily Evangeline took care of it. My sister Jill was the one that got it worse. I'll tell you about that too. When my encounter with the doll happened, I finished taking a bath, got dressed, and exited the bathroom. I was humming some song to myself when my breath stopped. The first thing I saw was a chubby porcelain doll sitting on my bed facing me. She had red hair styled in pigtails and a black dress that looked similar to those dresses Evangeline wears. Her green eyes weren't empty eyes of a doll. It actually felt like something is looking at me from that doll. The rule immediately came to my mind and I slowly walked towards the door. I didn't take my eyes off the doll in case it did something to hurt me. I unlocked the door and immediately called out for Evangeline. "Cousin, can you please come?" My voice was getting shaky because anxiety took over me.
"What is it, Amelia?"
She climbed up the stairs, making eye contact with me.
"There's a doll in my bed."
I opened the door for her, revealing a doll that still sat on my bed.
"Dorothy, I didn't expect to see you in Amelia's room. Do you like it here?"
She approached the doll and kept conversation with her like she's a living being.
"This is Amelia's room. You can't stay here. Mama will make you a new dress if you behave."
She picked up the doll and carried it outside my bedroom like a real child. I felt shivers running down my spine. What is wrong with this odd woman? That's a freaking doll that's probably haunted because it appeared here out of nowhere. I wanted to ask her something, but she walked downstairs, so I just locked my bedroom door and sat on the bed. My sister Jill got in trouble with a doll named Evelyn. You see, every doll in this household has a name and its personality. Evangeline refers to them as kids, but she never answered more questions. She just warned us about their unpredictable nature. Jill and I were in the guest room where that doll usually sits on her shelf. Jill was trying to take the book next to the doll, but she accidentally touched it. The doll immediately gripped her hand, earning a scream from Jill that desperately tried to pull away. The doll gripped so hard that Jill's hand started bleeding. She was crying at that point.
"Somebody help! Lizzie!"
I called from the hallway, looking back at Jill that was struggling. The doll kept her blank expression, only her hand gripped tighter no matter how hard Jill pulled back. She didn't move an inch from the shelf.
"Amelia, what's happening?"
Lizzie rushed up the stairs.
"Doll grabbed Jill!"
I pulled her inside and immediately rushed towards Jill, whose hand was bleeding. "Find Evangeline," she ordered, and I immediately rushed down. Evangeline finished feeding Cordelia, and she rushed up with me.
"Let her go, Evelyn," she ordered from the entrance.
The doll immediately let go of Jill, who fell down, gripping her hand.
I didn't mean to touch it. I wanted that book,"
Jill sobbed, looking at Evangeline.
"I know."
Instead of helping my sister, she walked towards the doll and took it in her hands.
"Mama needs to clean you up, Eve."
And she exited the room. The only thing that Evangeline treats like this is Cordelia. She calls herself her mama. That kind of shows her more gentle side, if she even has one, like a normal person. After we helped Jill, I asked Lizzie about the dolls, but she just said she acted like this towards them from the beginning. They're only friendly towards her. Other people will have a bad time with those dolls if they touch them. It's like she has some special connection with them. I didn't have more problems with those dolls aside from feeling of being watched from time to time, but everything in this house can give you severe anxiety. The last thing that I will write about today is the creature named Lottie. I promised I would share that experience with you too. Guess who's responsible for breaking this rule? My sister Billy. She's probably the reason why we will die one day. We went shopping with my mom, who refused to buy her a new toy, which caused her to cry when she came home. Not just that. Mom also got mad at her, which resulted in a full argument with Billy crying, yelling, and throwing things. Anne tried to remind them that it's 3:30 p.m. and we shouldn't be too loud, but with no avail. The whole scene stopped when Evangeline walked into the room.
"Silence yourself and your brat. We need to get out now."
"Why?" My mom was cut off by Evangeline.
"Because you woke Lottie up. Now follow me if you find your limbs precious."
Lizzie appeared in the room too and escorted us outside through the back door. Evangeline carried Cordelia in her arms. When we exited, she turned to Billy.
"I think I will have to lock you up if it's the only thing that will make you obey the rules."
"Mom?"
Billy hid behind my mother, who told her Evangeline wasn't serious about it.
"Why do you hate her so much?"
Jill asked.
"I do not. I feel two things. Hate is a second emotion I can feel, but it's not reserved for her. I don't hate children."
She made eye contact with Jill, then lifted her head up to look at one of the windows. We did the same thing and noticed a creature that could be heard roaming around the house. It was a headless woman who carried her head with wet, dark blue hair in her head. She also didn't have a right leg, which looked like it was ripped from her body. She had all sorts of sharp objects that stabbed into her. Her eyes on that head were blindfolded with a white cloth that had bloodstains on it. She walked in a really unnatural and creepy way that still gives me nightmares. That Lottie thing started weeping and making a sound like her vocal cords were badly damaged. It was so loud, we could hear it outside.
"What's happening now?"
My mom looked at Lizzie, then Evangeline. Her face was pale.
"We'll have to wait until she falls asleep again,"
Lizzie responded, looking up again.
"The best is to take a walk,"
Evangeline said and turned around, walking towards the gate. We followed behind her, glancing at each other.